honestly did not expect to come back to Squaresoft so soon after Parasite Eve. But after watching the Super Gaming Brothers Let's Play this game, I figured I'd give it a look for myself. So let's go back to 1998 with Squaresoft still riding the high that was Final Fantasy VII. Parasite Eve had just come out a little bit ago, but they decided, hey, Nintendo has Zelda, we can do something like that. And that's what people like to think was the main reason why Brave Fencer Musashi was considered.
Brave Fencer Musashi was released Halloween 1998 in North America, and while it didn't become a smash hit, it still garnered quite a bit of a cult following that still lasts to this day. So let's be honest, the only reason people picked it up was because some copies came bundled with a demo for Final Fantasy VIII. Along with the company's flagship series though, this game is an action-adventure game, again, similar to Nintendo's Legend of Zelda series. Before we get into anything else, let's start with the plot. The All-You-Can-Eat Kingdom is under attack from the Thirst Quencher Empire.
Get used to those kinds of jokes, people are all over the goddamn place.
At the behest of her advisor, Stuart Ribson, Princess Fillette uses a Bincho Tapefield to summon a child named Musashi, named after one of the most famous samurai warriors in history, Miyamoto Musashi, from another world to help protect them. He's a little hesitant at first, but concedes once he's promised to be sent back home when he completes his task. So after being given a sword called Fusion, he's sent to fetch a sword called Lumina, the fabled Sword of Luminescence. Musashi's absence gives a soldier from the Thirst Quencher Empire named Rutrick the chance to invade the palace to take the prisoner hostage, agreeing to free her if Musashi hands over Lumina. Musashi doesn't go for it, so he has to fight a mechanical monstrosity known as the Steam Knight. Later on, he's told by Ribson and Livers the Butler that Lumina isn't at full power yet and will only reach full power once Musashi collects 5 scrolls, based off the elements of fire, earth, water, air, and sky. In addition to gathering the scrolls, he also has to liberate the respective crests by defeating the Crest Guardians. He's also tasked with rescuing not only Princess Fillette, but everyone else who has been taken captive by the Empire and sealed away into Bincho Fields. And so Musashi is off, using the nearby Grillin Village as his base of operations. I'll get into what you can do in the village later, but right now he has to find his way to the Earth Scroll, which he can only do after freeing a criminal named John from the stocks. John helps Musashi build a raft, which Musashi uses to traverse the river to find the Earth Scroll. Oh, and it turns out that Lumina talks.
Earth Scroll has been absorbed.
I'm getting bad Sonic and the Black Knight flashbacks.
You are the chosen one. You are but a squire.
Musashi soon faces off against the Crest Guardian, Sculpion, with the assistance of some people he frees from the Bincho Tide along the way. I suppose I can get into this now. With each Crest Guardian you defeat, you can make use of that particular power. For instance, the Earth Crest gives Musashi the ability to create small earthquakes, the Water Crest lets him walk across water and put out fire, the Fire Crest acts as a flamethrower, the Air Crest lets him move the rare moments of high speed, and the Sky Crest lets him fly for a short period of time. You gain access to each of these powers only when the respective Crest Guardian is defeated. Back to the story, it's not hard to find. After the Earth Crest is liberated, Grillin Village faces a new problem in the form of creatures called Vampies, part vampire, part zombies. These creatures, as we learn from Twin Sisters Bubbles and Ginger Ale, are part of a plan by the Thirst Quencher Empire to create the ultimate soldier, and like vampires, they only come out at night. Musashi discovers that they're coming out of a temple hidden beneath the town's restaurant, which the town drunk, they say, is suffering from a sugar high due to all the caffeine and soda, but I ain't buying that shit, this bastard's fucking drunk, has accidentally released in search for some hidden treasure. Musashi manages to seal up the temple, but we still have a Vambi problem to deal with. To make things worse, one of the kids in the village was bitten by a Vambi. So now Musashi has to find a cure, which he succeeds in doing, and takes down the second Crest Guardian in the process. Not long after that, we're introduced to two new characters, Big Oaf Ben and Stuttering Idiot Ed, members of the Thirst Quencher Empire's Elite Leaders Force. They were responsible for stealing the church bell, which allowed Bubbles to make the church the center of the Vambi invasion. Don't ask me how that works, because it makes no sense. While all this is going on, the third member of Leader's Force, Topo, notices the Captain Princess Blade summon another hero from Musashi's world. This is Kojiro, who has some kind of a vendetta against Musashi. Musashi and Kojiro face off in a riverbed with the princess as the prize. Musashi comes out the victor, and after returning her to the palace, continues his search for the rest of the scrolls. Not long after, he learns that the princess is imposing a tax on the village. Musashi investigates, discovering that Topo has been disguised as the princess the entire time. With the money returned to the village, Musashi gets back to work defeating the Windcrest Guardian in an ant's nest. He finds the final scroll shortly before discovering the Empire's floating fortress called Soda Fountain. Musashi boards the ship and makes his way through Leader's Force, taking out Ben first, then Ed. Topo, on the other hand, I don't know what happens to her. Anyway, after a game of dance or die, her fate is left rather ambiguous. It's implied she literally danced herself to death, but unlike Ben and Ed, we don't see her die. After defeating the final Crest Guardian, Musashi confronts Fuhrer Flatsky, the leader of the Third Squadron Empire. Oh, John's here too, disguised as one of Flatsky's soldiers, Colonel Capricola. Anyway, Flatsky reveals that he wanted Musashi to liberate the Five Scrolls so he could then take Lumina from him and make it so that Musashi did all the work. Unfortunately, no one anticipated this little plot twist. You see, according to legend, the brave Fencer Musashi used Lumina to defeat a powerful being known as the Wizard of Darkness. But now that the sword has absorbed the powers of the Five Scrolls, it turns out that the Wizard of Darkness was actually sealed inside Lumina. Its first act is to crush Fuhrer Flatsky after the latter shoots and kills John.
Dark.
Musashi and the princess escape but are stopped by Kojiro, who still wants to fight Musashi and is once again using the princess's leverage. Too bad for him, he gets absorbed into the Wizard of Darkness, which shrinks down to something more feasible for Musashi to fight. Singing has three forms of the all pack a punch to use all of those skills you learn throughout the course of the journey to fight it. With the Wizard of Darkness defeated and the Thirst Quencher Empire taken down, Musashi brings the princess back to the palace where the king and queen has just gotten back from vacation. Musashi returns Lumina to its resting place, and it's implied that he's sent home off screen. With all that done, the game is completed. Well, the story anyway, the game itself is presented in an isometric view. What that means is that the camera is facing down at Musashi at a slight angle. For another Squaresoft game to compare it to, think of the battle screen for Final Fantasy Tactics. Since it's a free-roaming game from Squaresoft, Musashi is able to move all over the place and even jump, but the main gameplay elements are in swords, fusion, and Lumina. Let's talk fusion first. Fusion is used with the square button, and by holding down the R1 button, you can charge it up. Pressing the square button when fusion is fully charged allows Musashi to throw the sword to assimilate certain enemies' abilities. These abilities can be used in battle or to traverse the area. Lumina, in contrast, is used with the triangle button, and can make use of the Five Scrolls as I talked about earlier. It is much harder, especially as Musashi levels up, but it's also much slower than fusion, so use some caution. Though when fighting the Crest Guardians, don't be afraid to smack their cords with Lumina. Crest Guardians themselves aren't too terribly difficult, their fights just go on for quite a while, especially the final Crest Guardian, the Tower of Death. That one can suck a dick. Now let's talk about Grillin Village, shall we? It's Musashi's base of operations. You can shop at the grocery store, sleep and save at the inn, talk to the mayor, buy toys, or get hit on by the lady at the restaurant.
I need an adult?
I am an adult!
You'll also have to save the town once or twice, such as the aforementioned Bambi incident. But before that, the nearby power plant Steamwood goes haywire, once because it's being overloaded, and the second time because Topo sabotages it. There's also the giant ants that lead Musashi to defeating the Wind Crest Guardian. The isometric 3D view makes the platforming segments in this game a bit of a pain to do at times. It's especially noticeable when going through the temple into the restaurant. If you played Sonic 3D Blast, you should know what I'm talking about. You may get used to it after a while, but that doesn't make it any less annoying. I can get used to living with a tapeworm, but that doesn't mean I have to like it. Graphically speaking, it doesn't look too bad, for the console standards anyway, though you can tell that Squaresoft was transitioning from the Popeye designs of Final Fantasy VII to the more realistic designs of Parasite Eve and Final Fantasy VIII, as everyone has a somewhat cartoonish and chibi appearance to them. Then again, the game itself is rather cartoony, doesn't take itself seriously at all until the very end. Though I would like to just ask how Musashi got his hair to look like that. I mean, fuck, I thought Teazelbon's hair was ridiculous, and that guy makes Yuki Moto's look tame by comparison. While we're on the subject of anime, tell me Musashi's voice sounds familiar.
Weird looking rock. Looks kinda slimy.
That's because Musashi is voiced by Mona Marshall, best known as Izzy from the English dub of Digimon Adventure. Kojiro is voiced by Barbara Goodson, who did the English voice for Rita Repulsa and Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, while most of the other voices go under aliases. For instance, John's voice actor David Lucas is an alias for Steve Bloom. This could be because they were acting outside the Screen Actors Guild Union, though I'm not sure about the politics behind the whole thing. While we're on the subject of the sound, holy shit, this soundtrack is amazing. There's just one problem with it. Half the songs aren't on the official soundtrack! Square Enix, you really need to get that fixed. You gave this game a not as good sequel in 2005, so why not release the official soundtrack? Maybe on the off chance we get a remake? Then again, considering how long it's taken us to get Kingdom Hearts 3 and the first part of Final Fantasy 7 remake, I highly doubt a remake is going to happen anytime soon.
Brave Fencer Musashi is one of those games that I would like to classify as a hidden gem of the PlayStation. And look, finding it though, physical copies are rare, and to my knowledge, it hasn't been released digitally on the PlayStation Network. But enough about that. Next time we meet, we're going back to the world of survival horror with Resident Evil 4.
Just can't be defined. Find the power to decide.